isn't real.
What is real? How do you define real? If you're talking about what you can feel, what you can smell, what you can taste and see, then real is simply electrical signals interpreted by your brain.
Okay, so get ready, because today we're going deep on something that might mess with your head a little bit.
Sounds intriguing.
We're diving into an essay called The Construction of Reality. It's by D. Turner. And, it basically argues that the media we consume, especially these days, can really warp our sense of what's actually real.
Yeah, that's a pretty unsettling thought, isn't it? To think that we're not just passively watching or reading or listening.
Right. Like, it's not just entertainment. It's actually shaping how we see the world.
It really makes you question everything you thought you knew.
It does. And the essay uses some pretty fascinating examples to illustrate this point. We're talking about figures like Alexander the Great.
Oh, wow. Alexander the Great.
And then there's Andy Kaufman.
The comedian. Interesting choice.
And even Whitley Strieber.
Okay, so we've got a historical conqueror, a comedian, and Strieber's known for his alien abduction stories, right?
Exactly. What could these three possibly have in common? Well, that's what we're going to find out.
Okay.
And trust me, their stories shed light on how we construct reality in ways you might not have imagined.
Okay, I'm hooked. Let's start with Alexander the Great. I guess most people know the story of the Gordian knot.
Yeah, the one that was so intricate and tangled that no one could untie it.
Right. It was like the ultimate puzzle. And whoever could solve it was supposedly destined to rule all of Asia.
So what did Alexander do? Did he spend years trying to unravel it like everyone else?
Nope. He had a different approach. You see, for centuries, people tried to untie the Gordian knot in the traditional way, painstakingly searching for the loose ends.
But Alexander, being Alexander, probably got impatient.
You could say that. He basically just took his sword and sliced right through it.
Wow. Talk about a power move.
It was definitely that, but it also symbolizes a much deeper shift in thinking.
Okay, I'm curious. How does cutting a knot relate to our perception of reality?
It shows that Alexander refused to accept the reality that was presented to him. He didn't play by the rules. Instead, he redefined the challenge itself. He shaped reality through bold action.
So it wasn't just about conquering a physical knot. It was about conquering the limitations imposed by conventional thinking.
Precisely. And this concept still resonates today. Think about groundbreaking advancements in science, technology, art.
They often involve going against the grain, right? Challenging the status quo.
Exactly. It's about having that cut the Gordian knot mentality. Not accepting limitations, but actively seeking ways to transcend them.
Hmm. That's pretty powerful. So we've got Alexander the Great hacking away at the status quo. Now let's jump to Andy Kaufman, who seemed to build his entire career around blurring the lines of reality.
Ah, Andy Kaufman, a true original. His whole career was like this giant performance art piece, always pushing boundaries, leaving audiences wondering what was real and what was staged.
Yeah, like his wrestling career. That was a prime example. He embraced this outrageous villain persona, picking fights, even declaring himself the intergender wrestling champion.
The thing is, it wasn't just a gimmick. He was genuinely wrestling those matches, provoking real reactions for people. It completely blurred the lines between performance and reality.
It was brilliant and unsettling at the same time. You could never quite tell if he was serious or if it was all a giant joke.
That ambiguity was his genius. He tapped into our fascination with spectacle and how it can warp our perception of what's real.
It's almost like he predicted the rise of reality TV.
Right, where manufactured drama and heightened emotions are the main attractions.
It's all about creating a spectacle that keeps people hooked, even if it's not entirely authentic.
Exactly. And in today's media landscape, it's more relevant than ever. With the constant barrage of information, it can be incredibly difficult to discern truth from fabrication.
It really is like trying to find a needle in a haystack.
And that brings us to our third example, Whitley Strieber and his controversial book, Communion.
Oh yeah, the one about his supposed alien encounters.
Exactly. Strieber's work delves into the power of personal experiences and how they shape our realities, even if those experiences challenge conventional thinking.
His descriptions of his encounters were so vivid and emotionally charged that they captivated readers worldwide.
And what made his work so controversial was that he presented these encounters as completely genuine, even though they defied mainstream scientific explanations.
It sparked a lot of debate. Some dismissed it as pure fiction, while others were convinced by his sincerity and the vivid details he provided.
It raises a crucial question. In a world where reality is often constructed, whose reality do we prioritize? The expert with the scientific data, or the individual with the lived experience?
That's a tough one. Especially today when personal narratives are amplified through platforms like social media, the lines between objective truth and subjective experience have become incredibly blurry.
It's a complex issue, and it's only going to become more challenging as technology continues to evolve.
So we've got Alexander the Great challenging conventions, Andy Kaufman blurring lines, and Whitley Strieber pushing the boundaries of accepted experience. What does all of this tell us about how reality is constructed?
It suggests that what we perceive as real is not fixed. It's fluid, constantly being shaped by cultural forces, individual perceptions, and the narratives we choose to embrace.
So how do we make sense of all this? Is there a way to understand how these forces are shaping our world?
Well, to unpack this further, we need to explore the work of Jean Baudrillard and his theory of simulation. It might sound a bit intimidating, but trust me, it's fascinating stuff.
Okay, I'm ready. Bring on the simulation.
So Baudrillard's theory, this theory of simulation, it gives us a way to understand how our perception of reality is being shaped in a world that's just saturated with media.
Okay, I'm all ears. How does this theory connect media and our sense of what's real?
Well, he says we experience these simulations in four distinct stages.
Four stages, huh? That sounds a little complicated. Can you break that down a bit?
Sure. Let's start with the first stage. Imagine like a painting or a photograph that's trying to depict the real world as accurately as possible.
Okay, so a straightforward depiction, like a mirror, just reflecting what's there.
Exactly. Then we move to the second stage, and here's where their representation starts to distort reality a bit. Think of a caricature where certain features are exaggerated.
Right, to make us laugh or to emphasize a point. It's still based on reality, but with a twist.
Precisely. Now, the third stage, this is where things get a little more complex. The simulation starts to mask the absence of a real referent. It's creating an illusion of reality, even if there's nothing substantial beneath the surface.
Okay, now that's where it starts to get a little creepy. Can you give me a concrete example of this third stage?
Think about reality TV. It presents itself as this window into real lives and experiences, but it's all carefully crafted to be more dramatic, more exciting, more engaging than everyday life.
Right. It creates this hyper-real world that we get sucked into, even though we know deep down it's not entirely authentic.
And then we arrive at the fourth stage, pure simulation. This is where the simulation becomes so pervasive, so convincing, that it completely replaces any sense of an underlying reality.
Wow, so it's not even a distortion or an illusion anymore. It becomes our reality.
At this stage, the line between the real and the simulated dissolves completely. We're immersed in this world of signs and symbols that have become detached from any authentic experience.
Whoa, are we already in this fourth stage? It definitely feels like it sometimes, especially with all this VR stuff popping up.
It's definitely a possibility. Think about how much time we spend online crafting these digital personas on social media.
Right. It's like we're constantly performing for this invisible audience.
And with deepfakes now, where videos and images can be manipulated to depict things that never actually happened, well, it makes it even harder to figure out what's real and what's fake.
It's mind-blowing. Like, we have to constantly question everything we see and hear, even if it seems totally real. This whole thing makes me think of The Matrix. That movie really played with these ideas about simulated realities.
The Matrix definitely tapped into our anxieties about technology and its power to control how we see the world.
Yeah, that idea of living in a simulation controlled by AI, it really resonated with a lot of people.
It captured the cultural zeitgeist, for sure. And what's interesting is that The Matrix actually helped to make Baudrillard's theories more accessible to a wider audience. It took these complex ideas and brought them into the mainstream.
So we've talked about how individuals like Alexander the Great and Andy Kaufman challenged our understanding of reality. And then we dove into Baudrillard's theory of simulation and how it's playing out in this media-saturated world we live in.
Right. But this whole idea of constructing reality, it's not new. The essay argues that it's been evolving throughout human history, just taking different forms in different eras.
So how has our way of constructing reality changed over time?
Well, the essay breaks it down into several periods. In the prehistoric era, reality was rooted in immediate physical experiences and communal knowledge passed down through oral traditions.
That makes sense. I mean, when your survival depends on understanding the natural world, there's not much room for individual interpretations.
Then, as societies became more complex, we see these religious and mythological frameworks emerge. And these frameworks, they start to shape people's understanding of their place in the universe.
So reality becomes intertwined with spiritual beliefs and cultural narratives.
Exactly. And with the rise of secularism during the Enlightenment, we see a shift towards national and cultural identities as these driving forces.
So it's less about divine decree and more about shared values and aspiration.
Right. And finally, we arrive at the postmodern era where simulation reigns supreme and reality becomes fragmented and personalized.
So instead of having this shared reality based on tangible experiences, we now have all these individual realities being constructed through our interactions with media and technology.
You got it. It's almost as if reality itself has become a choose-your-own-adventure story.
And that shift has some pretty major implications for, well, everything from art and culture to social interactions, even our understanding of truth itself. This whole choose-your-own-adventure reality thing, It's fascinating but kind of scary too. What happens to our sense of truth when reality becomes so fluid and subjective?
Well, that's a question that's becoming more and more relevant. If everyone's just constructing their own reality based on, you know, their experiences, their beliefs, the information they choose to consume, then this idea of a shared objective truth, it starts to fall apart.
It's like we're all living in these separate universes speaking different languages. Uh-huh. How can we even find common ground when we can't agree on basic facts?
It's a recipe for division and polarization, for sure. When people feel like their version of reality is being threatened, they tend to double down on their beliefs and become resistant to dialogue or compromise.
And social media, it just makes it worse, right? All those echo chambers constantly feeding us information that confirms our biases.
The role of media in shaping our realities is huge. These platforms have so much power to filter and control the information we see. It's more important than ever to be critical thinkers, to question what we're consuming, and to seek out diverse perspectives.
But how do we even do that when we're drowning in information overload?
Awareness is key. We need to recognize that we're not just passive recipients of information. We're actively constructing our realities based on the choices we make about what to consume and who to trust.
So it's not just about being skeptical of everything, but about being mindful of the sources we choose, the filters we apply.
Exactly. And it also takes a willingness to engage with people who hold different views than our own, to listen with empathy, to try to understand where they're coming from, and to find common ground even when we disagree.
That's easier said than done, though.
Right.
In today's world, disagreement often turns into hostility and personal attacks.
It's definitely not easy, but it's crucial. Building bridges requires humility, curiosity, and a willingness to acknowledge that our own perspectives are limited.
It's a good reminder that even the things we hold to be true, those can change as we encounter new information and perspectives.
The construction of reality is an ongoing process. It's not about finding all the answers. It's about embracing the ambiguity and complexity of the world.
So in this world where reality is so fluid, what happens to the world of religion? I mean, it's traditionally provided a sense of shared meaning and purpose.
That's a really interesting question. For centuries, religion served as a framework for understanding reality. But now, in a world where people are constructing their own personalized belief systems, traditional doctrines can seem less relevant or authoritative.
It seems like religion is having to adapt to this new landscape, where faith is becoming more individualized and less tied to institutions.
We are seeing a shift towards more inclusive and flexible approaches. Some religious groups are emphasizing personal experience and spiritual exploration over strict adherence to dogma. Others are incorporating secular thought and scientific understanding into their teachings.
It's like religion is trying to meet people where they are recognizing that faith can manifest in many different ways.
It's an evolution that reflects the changing ways in which people are finding meaning and purpose in their lives.
This whole conversation has really made me question everything I thought I knew about reality.
That's the beauty of exploring these ideas. It's not about finding definitive answers, but about embracing the ongoing process of constructing reality.
So what's the key takeaway for our listeners? What can they do to navigate this complex landscape of constructed realities?
Be aware that reality is not fixed. It's fluid and dynamic, shaped by so many different factors. Be critical thinkers, be discerning about the information you consume, and be open to different perspectives.
And maybe most importantly, be mindful of the realities you're creating for yourselves and how those realities impact the world around you.
Remember, we're all in this together. We all play a role in shaping the reality we inhabit.
And that's all the time we have for today's deep dive into the construction of reality. But the conversation doesn't have to end here. Keep questioning, keep exploring, and keep constructing your own unique and meaningful reality.
Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time for another deep dive.